And there is one thing I said very quickly, and which was ridiculous. So you remember I introduced L, the set of lattices. And E, the set of elliptic curves. And I said there is a map, which is the quotient by C star. And I spoke very quickly of a bundle. This was by no means accurate. I mean, this was wrong. What you have to do is something more, slightly more subtle. You have to introduce first L quiver, which is the product of L multiplied by C and divided by C star by the multiplicative action. But even then, it's a bit incorrect. Now this looks like a bundle, and now this sits over E. But what is not correct, moreover, so I forgot to pass from L to L twiddle, but what is still incorrect is that the fact that you may have automorphism from C star on R, on an element in R. So if you draw the standard picture, you have this point and this point, which have a stabilizer, and moreover, any point, you have plus or minus one, which stabilize. So it's really incorrect to say that it is a bundle. To make things correct, you have to transform the problem. You have to rigidify the problem by going to some covering using some congruent subgroup. So you have to go to En and Ln. So I forgot all these details, which are not details.
N should be greater than 2.
N should be greater, I don't remember, 2 or 3 or...
Starting from 3.
Starting from 3, yes. Yeah. So I forgot to say that. This is absolutely classical, but I was really completely careless in stating it. So I must apologize for this stupid, very classical mistake. But
if you say step everything, that's it.
Of course. But I don't want to enter this subtlety. So that's one correction. So it was really not L, but L. So to have and we know and 30. That was the line bundle I had in mind, but I wrote things very too quickly and it was wrong. Okay. The second correction for one. The second correction is also something one often forgets. So you remember, for an automorphic form, I said one can define what is called the constant term along some parabolic. So I wrote it Fn. So first of all, the good notation is not Fn, it's Fp. But I would prefer this as a notation, where P is parabolic, it's a group.
However, it depends on N orbit.
The integration is on N, but it's the P defines N. So it's a unipotent radical of P. But so Fn is classical as a notation, but it's better to use Fp. And the second thing, which really is something I forgot, I said that one says that F is cuspidal if Fp is 0 for all p, and I forgot to say for all p different from g. Otherwise, if you include g, then the function has to be 0, which is not this yet. So I forgot to say that. So only proper parabolics.
So,
okay.
So that's the correction.
There may have been other stupid mistake, but I don't remember all that at least. Okay, this was a problem for me in the night. Suddenly it came back. Okay, the second thing is that I have decided to switch the subject of the between lecture 2 and 3 because in fact they are independent, and I thought it would be better to go on what I was speaking yesterday. And moreover, Colin Gorshin won't be in the next lecture. He is more interested in the third lecture than in the second. So I decided to change it. And so I will go on with that and discuss today the press formula. And go back to the Lamblin's parametrization on the next lecture. So, so just to start afresh, the lecture for today. So, lecture. It's not two, but it's two prime. So, press formula. Okay. So, in fact, this goes back as probably you know to Selberg in 56, and so in fact, what if you don't know what is the Drake's formula? There is some comment I should make. I will draw a picture. So you have index theorem. You have Lefschetz formula, or Riemann-Rohr also. And Lefschetz stress formula. And also Selberg. All these objects are particular case of some common object. I don't know where it exists. It exists in some, at least, metamathematical thing. But there are definitely situations where this is known, this is known. But there are definitely situations where all this coincide. So it's really, you have to have to consider that the Selberg press formula is in some special case it coincides with the index theorem or Riemann-Rohr theorem, except that you have more structure, so less flexibility in some sense, because it's only the manifold to which you apply it will be homogeneous spaces. They will be the spaces from yesterday. So G over K over gamma, objects like that. So it's very special objects. But you have many more operators for which you compute something which looks like the index in some cases. So you restrict the manifold, the type of manifold, but you can apply it to many more objects. So it's not the same generality, but still. But there are definitely objects that are in common. Okay. That's just a philosophical comment. So, just as a start, I will describe the first case, the compact case. Just to give you the notations and all the feeling of what's going on. So here G will be a locally compact. A locally compact. just local code. And gamma will be a discrete. And since I am in the co-compact case, co-compact, which means that G over gamma is compact. So in this situation, you have a well-defined object, the L2 of gamma and the G. And on this, you have an action of G on the right, and an action of the space of smooth, compactly supported function on G. There is a small comment here. The smooth, also compact support is not a problem, but smooth, you might think it's strange to say smooth for any locally compact group. But in fact, this makes sense. This is a Breuer thesis. That's an observation. Infinity makes sense. Thanks to it's not so well known, but still.
But sorry, funny question. Why you don't use gravitations?
Which is what?
So this is E without it's infinity, it is not Breuer.
Yeah. But
it is
but
more American, you see.
Yes, but it's good to think of it as a smooth function. If you are on a Lie group, it's a smooth function.
Yes.
If you are on a periodic group, it's a locally
just
constant.
Yes.
It's just locally constant, and the general case is built out of these two things, in fact. So and so it's just what you should have in mind when you think of smooth and compactly supported.
I have another funny question. We also have chosen a hard version of G, I guess.
Of course. So I forgot to say that. You choose any hard measure, G hard measure.
Ah, essentially the fundamental dimensions will not work on it.
So hard measure. So you may wonder whether it's left or right hard measure. But since it is compact, then G is necessarily unimodular. When you have a co-compact, if there exists a co-compact discrete subgroup, then the R measure is certainly left and right invariant. G is certainly unimodular. This is an exercise, okay. You may put it as an assumption, but this is automatic.
But we normalize it so that...
No, we don't normalize
it. You do not.
Never.
And when we write L2, we consider the induced measure on G.
You have...
The
definition of L2 is independent of the choice of the R measure. The scalar product is well defined up to a scalar. The space of function is independent.
That's the
now, if you want to...
So we are not fixing...
No, you choose one, but doesn't matter.
We're not fixing it.
No, it's...
Make him respect. Okay.
Well, in fact, to be more, even more accurate, if you want to see that, the way one should look at these objects should be the product of the R measure and the function.
Yeah.
So you should look at measures that are smooth and compactly supported, with a smooth and compactly supported density, which shows you that there is no choice. No, it's not necessary to have a choice. In fact, the proper way is to work with measures. So, the R measure is absolutely irrelevant. Okay, so now, once you have, a function f in a smooth, this is only if you have phi.
I'm sorry, C means compact support.
C means compact support,
yes.
In L2 of gamma of G, well, you can build a kind of a variant of the convolution, which is simply what I call R of F or O of F. And the right regular representation applied to C for F is just the integral of G of phi of x, y, f of y, dy. Oh. R of f is an operator. The right regular representation. R stands for right regular representation. Okay, and the key observation, which goes back to the Zelmer, which is, as you will see, completely trivial in some sense, but that's the basic object for all the theory. So this can be rewritten. So I write again. Sorry. Phi of x, y, f of y, y. A change of variable gives you this phi of y, f of x minus 1, y, dy. And now it can be rewritten as the integral g over gamma of phi of y, so I will shift the phi on the other side, the sum for gamma in gamma of f of x minus 1 gamma y, phi of y, dy. So, these are the basic computations you have to have seen at least once in your life. And then, you see here one object I will call k or kf of xy. This is a kernel. This is a so-called kernel. I rewrite the formula. Just the sum of gamma and gamma of f of s minus 1 gamma y. So this is a basic object for the trace formula. So this is a function which which is built out of f. Since f is compactly supported, this series converges, obviously. And and here, since g over gamma is compact, you will have the following observation. Is that the integral of g over gamma of integral of g over gamma of kf of x y squared dx dy? This is compact. This is a continuous function. So this is bound. You have a continuous function on a compact space. This is bound. So it tells you that the kf is square integrable. It belongs to N2 of g over gamma, cross g over gamma. In other words, this operator is of Hilbert-Schmidt type. So this is Hilbert-Schmidt. In particular, so we have to. So we can analyze this, I guess.
So, you have a family of operators, so you have, say, bounded operators, for example. So this is a set. Inside of it, for example, you have compact operators in an Hilbert space. Compact operators. Inside, you have Hilbert unit. And here, since you have even more regular objects, you are on a compact space, so you have also trace class operator. They are even more regular. So the point is that for each F. In the as of most compactly comported function, you get RF, which is Hilbert-Schmidt, hence compact. It's a compact operator. Now, there is an exercise, a proposition. If you have a space. So I should maybe write X for G over gamma. If you have an Hilbert space with a setup, so you have a space with a representative, so say, H and R, Hilbert space. Representation such that representation of G such that R of F is compact for all F smooth compactly supported on G, which is our situation, then H is a direct sum completed of space H pi with H pi is the space of our representation pi tensor some vector space M pi, where plane, where pi v pi is an irreducible unitary representation. So pi and v of pi is a space. Sorry, sometimes I put the representation before or below, I'm sorry. Is an irreducible unitary representation. And M of pi is just a vector space with no action. No action, but the property, the essential property is of finite dimension. It's finite. So if you have many compact operators, then the decomposition is discrete with finite multiplicity. So this is an exercise which is not very difficult. If you don't succeed in doing it, I can't do it, but the way you do that, if you have a compact operator, you can first build
take F convolution with F change. So you get self-adjoint operators. Now self-adjoint operator, you diagonalize them. Since it is compact, you get a diagonalized operator with eigenvalue appearing with finite multiplicities. That's one thing. And what you have to do is to see what happens when the function f, or rather the function, the measure of f dg, f of x dx, when it approaches the Dirac measure at the origin. And you let this approach the Dirac measure at the origin, so the measure f of x dx. And since you can approach easily the Dirac measure, since this is valid for all function f, you construct invariant basis. I won't do it. It takes 10-15 minutes to do it. So I think it's too long. It's really elementary.
But maybe I can ask you some background.
Yes,
because I'm used to this. So we require from the very beginning that G is the representation of G on H is unitary, right?
Yes.
I didn't say that, but
maybe it's implied.
I said you got space, so presupposes, so unitary.
And of course, the representation on M2 is unitary, right?
Of course.
Yeah. And also, then I would like to ask you. So for any unitary representation, we get an action of the K-Gauss group G, right?
Yeah, you can call this the K-Gauss group.
It's more special case. It's more general.
Yes, it's a very general. It's just an abstract number.
The point is not that. Maybe not gate algebra, but at least algebra. So you get a representation of it, right?
Yes. Yes. When I say representation of G, I understand representation of the group itself or representation of the algebra of function of it.
Yes, this convolution. Yes.
It's essentially convolution. Yes.
So given a representation of
this is an algebra for convolution.
Uh-huh. So just to understand the structure of this, so do we have an equivalence of the categories? I don't know. Of maybe unitary representation do not form an abelian category.
I have no idea.
What is the dictionary between the representation of G and the representation of the algebraic convolution? Which kind of lower modules of algebraic convolution do you get from unitary representation?
I never thought of that. I am afraid that the dictionary might be tricky. In some situation. That's a good question, of course. We play for automorphic representation. We play a game where sometimes we look at representation of the group. Sometimes we look at representation of the algebra, mainly representation of the algebra, of an algebra. Of the Hecker algebra, precisely. I didn't define it up to now in the global case. Yeah. So the Hecker algebra, since I make comments, the Hecker algebra, let's make a comment completely. What is the Hecker algebra for adult groups? So this I didn't discuss. So this is a parenthesis. But otherwise,
if it is more convenient for you, maybe we can specify it. I didn't want to.
No, but okay.
Thank you very much.
What is the algebra we have to look at? So now G is connected reductive group defined over say Q or F.
Okay.
And you have G, which is G of A, eta F. Okay? So G over F. Now what is the so-called Hecker algebra for G and F? Well, this is essentially, it is a restricted tensor product of local objects, so LHV. So, now if V is a finite place, HV is just this.
just the smooth compactly supported, so locally constant. Smooth in that case is locally constant. From compactly supported function. This is a convolution algebra. Convolution algebra of compactly supported. Locally constant functions. Okay? This is what you explain in your course, probably. Alors, now, what is it when V is a real place? Or a complex place? When this is an Archimedean place. So that's the point where it's not completely obvious. So where V is Archimedean, then you take for HV a mixture. I will write it. A mixture of the Lie algebra or the enveloping algebra and measures on and the action of how can I say that? And projectors on finite dimensional. Yeah, finite dimensional representation of KV, the maximal compact subgroup. The point is that if you want to consider automorphic forms. Automorphic forms are by definition K finite. If you let an element of G act, this destroys the K finiteness. The group doesn't act on K finite functions. It's okay at finite places because the open compact subgroup are preserved by the action of the conjugation by an element of the group. Here, the maximal compact subgroup is not preserved by, you get another one, but they are not at all commensurate. So you have to restrict to a kind of mixture. I won't make it precise, but you can let the Lie algebra act, and the enveloping algebra. You can let K, the compact act, of course it preserves K finiteness, but you cannot let the group act. So that's kind of a problem. So in fact, what one uses in between, one uses another object which is not strictly speaking the Ecker algebra, which is a space of smooth compactly supported on GV, and that are KV finite on both sides. This algebra is easier to define than the proper Ecker algebra, and this is enough for all purposes. Ah, this is what I will use permanently.
So why might I forget about this and use just this?
Yeah. But if you look really in the... So this acts on the space of k-finite objects, since functions are asked to be k-finite on both sides. So it's a convolution algebra. And, I don't look at any topology. You don't put any topology here. Here there is no topology. So, and now you see that this is obviously included. And the action of this is recovered when you have one, you can recover the other one. You can pass from one to the other.
But somehow it seems like this, we capture all the unified representations. Well, there are
No. I didn't say K invariant, I said K finite on both sides.
Ah, K finite.
K finite, not K invariant. So this is the kind of, so for finite places, the K finiteness is automatic because you,
For real places or complex places, then it's really different. It's a much smaller algebra than the algebra of all the convolutional algebra of the functions. And again, if you really want to be absolutely canonical, you don't speak of functions but of measures, and so on. So you multiply by the R measure, and it is really the convolutional algebra of measures with good densities. This is really the object. But it's traditionally presented like that, although it's incorrect, strictly speaking. Okay. So is this clear or not? What's the problem?
Not in the moment.
No, I can understand why it's in at medium place, why it's a mixture of universal Hamiltonian algebra. It's a definition, not a construction. It's a construction.
Yeah. So there is a construction. It appears, the first time it appeared, it's in Jacques Ellendorf's book. You look at the definition of the Hecker algebra.
But at medium place. At medium place, can you take the definition as you wrote here?
In the middle?
Yes.
It's not what is called the Hecker algebra.
It's not algebra.
It's an algebra, but I don't know the name. The algebra of k-finite functions, that's all. But it's not strictly speaking what Jacques Langlands defined as the Hecker algebra. In practice, these objects are the good ones. Okay. So now, I hope this is clear. So you have this proposition that tells you that in that case, the application, the corollary of the proposition, the corollary, that L2 of gamma under G, when it is compact, this is a direct sum of what I have written, Vp tensor M pi. So M pi is just a space for the multiplicity, just a stupid vector space. It plays no role, it's just a way to, or if you prefer, it's V pi to the power dimension of pi. The third dimension of n pi to the power n pi. It's equivalent. Okay, so you have this decomposition. So one says that the decomposition is discrete. It's a discrete sum. It's really a discrete sum of irreducible objects. So you only have a discrete spectrum. That's the way it is set. Okay. So that's a special simple case. The discrete spectrum is very nice. Unfortunately, in most applications, it won't be the case. Complications come from that. But for the moment, we forget about the complicated case. So now I can explain the press formula. So before doing that, I have to recall you a beautiful theorem due to Dixmier and Mariana, just to have a nice presentation of things. So when NAF in G smooth compactly supported in G can be written again, smooth for practical purposes. You can factor finite sums. Any function, any smooth compactly supported function, can be factorized, not strictly, but at least as a finite sum of a factorizable function. So it's a kind of regularity, and you can iterate the process, so you can have as many factors as you want.
What is the difference? So from the beginning, you have f is a smooth compact supported function.
Yes.
And fi and fi prime is also.
They are also smooth compactly supported. They are of the same nature.
What is the meaning of this?
The meaning is that any function f can be written as a sum of convolution products. A finite sum of convolution products.
Okay.
A finite sum of convolution products. So try to prove it for, I don't know, for. For a torus, it's okay, it's not too difficult. For R, it's already difficult. So
and you do, for any group G,
this is valid for any locally compact, any locally compact group G. Again, you want us to use the solution of the Hilbert problem describing all locally compact groups. So, in fact, it's really a theorem for any groups, and for other groups, it's just easy because you have. You have to know what is the description of the general locally compact group. You have a neighborhood of the identity, which is not a neighborhood. You have a neighborhood which is a product of a neighborhood in a group times totally disconnected compact group. So
you explained this result by Broad that we have to define
the fancy. Yes, exactly. So it's really a theorem. It's the theorem is for any group. That's where it is difficult. For the general case, it's just trivial once you know the structure of all perfectly compact groups. But I would prefer to present it in that way because it covers all cases. Okay, but the difficulty is for any groups. So you can factorize. Okay, then our R of F is the sum of R of I times R of F prime I. The representation is a homomorphism, the convolution algebra. Convolution is transformed into product. You know that these guys are Hilbert units. A product of two Hilbert Schmidt operators is a trace class operator. Roughly speaking, for self-adjoint compact operators, to be Hilbert Schmidt means that the sum of the square of the eigenvalue converge. To be of trace class means that the sum of the eigenvalue, for a positive self-adjoint operator, that the series of the eigenvalue is convergent. You have a Hilbert Schmidt is L2, Hilbert Schmidt is L2, trace class is L1 for the set of eigenvalues. So since R is a finite sum of products of Hilbert Schmidt, this is a trace class operator. Corollary, R of F is trace class. And even more, because you can factor as many terms, so it's even more than L1. But okay. The set of eigenvalue is rapidly decreasing. Not only integrable, but rapidly decreasing. Okay, but at least it's trace class. At least it's L1 in this sense. So okay, now I know already what should I erase. Thank you. So already I know that the place of all that is a sum of the number, the multiplicity, trace, pi of f. You know that already.
We're yet in the situation when grounding is co-compact.
It's always gamma co-compact. Yeah. So for all pi, generally the dual object is denoted by g hat. That's the tradition, g hat. The set of equivalent spaces of irreducible and of irreducible unitary representations of G. And of course, I insist, you're right, that gamma of G is compact. So sometimes M of pi is also denoted M index gamma of pi to echo that depends on gamma. That's another notation. Depends on what you want. On what you want to insist. So it's the multiplicity with which the representation pi occurs in L2 of G over gamma. Okay? So all the content of this thing is that this series exists and converge, and the numbers are fine. Okay, that's one side. That the spectral side, this is called the spectral side of the trace formula. Okay, now we shall discuss the geometric side. So it's just a reformulation of this decomposition plus the smaller, not trivial fact that the series converge. And in particular, all operators pi of f are press-class, which was not obvious. The pi of f that occur, the ones that do occur, are press-class. There may be other representations that are not for which pi of f is not price class, but you all understand what I mean by pi of f, or should I explain? Is it clear or not what I mean by pi of f? I think it's better to give just a short explanation. So, you have a representation pi of G in V pi. It's an Hilbert space, by hypothesis. So you take, say, V in V pi. Now you can consider pi of X V. This is again a vector for X in G. Now, you can integrate f of x, pi of x, v, dx. And this is, by definition, pi of f, v.
And so what are the conditions in general? What are the conditions for the
convergence? Implicitly, when I say representation, I assume that it is continuous, which means that this application x goes to this x, v. This is continuous. Mm. This is implicit in all
projection of this subspace. Yes.
Hmm?
Projection of this orthogonal subspace. Yes. P. Pi.
Projection? What do you mean by projection? What do you mean by projection? There is no projection of it. This is a for example, in the finite dimensional case, it's a matrix. Pi of X is a matrix, which depends on the group. on the element on the group. You have a representation, I don't know, of the rotations, and you have the matrix of a certain rotation, and B is a vector, and you, okay? So I don't understand why you say projection. There is no projection.
Sorry, I mean that you explain what is a pi of here, but you have before you explained the spectral decomposition of
representation. Yes.
It's because the projection of
that's true. You have a way to project I just erased the decomposition. So you have subspaces. I denoted H pi that are subspaces that are isomorphic to a certain multiple of V pi. Yeah. But now, in this, when this is written, there is no projection involved. Pi of F is defined in terms of pi and F itself. Yeah. The projection has completely disappeared.
Yeah. Okay.
So now we go to the geometric side. Okay, I'm going to keep this. So on the geometric side, well, you have another theorem or proposition. Assume that the kernel, so for the kernel, K of xy, is first, which satisfies the two properties. First, K is continuous as a function in xy, and two, K represents a trace class operator. Then the conclusion. The conclusion is a trace. So represented,
I will call it R. Sorry. It's a general theorem. Because
it's a general theorem.
Before that, in our particular situation, T is trace.
It will apply to our situation, but it's a general fact. When X is a space with a measure and the trace. So, I mean, it's a kernel, which means that this function acts by integrating by one variable on the space X. You have some space X, and the kernel acts by integration, like in our situation. Then the trace of R is the integral over the diagonal. So I need to say on X. Over k of x, x dx. Implicitly, I have a space L2 of x and dx. Just a generalization of the thing you all know, that when you have a finite, when you have a matrix, the trace is given by the sum of the coefficients of the diagonal. That's just fairly obvious. But you really have two serious assumptions that are not automatic in the infinite dimensional case. A priori, operators have no reason to be trace class, first of all. But even if they are trace class, there is no reason for the kernel to be a continuous function, because the kernel is defined by L2 condition. So you can modify the function on S cross X on a measure, on a set of measure zero. And in many cases, the diagonal in X cross X
the real unknown is of very often of measure zero. So you could modify the kernel as in a completely arbitrary way on the diagonal if it is measure zero. Well, you insist that it is continuous, so there is some topology and so on. So I don't want to enter all the details, but this prevents you to modify the function on the diagonal. Then the result is. So, in fact, you're not obliged to use this theorem. You can also look at this in another way. If the kernel varies, assume that the kernel k of xy is a product of the kernel, so it's integral over the depth of k1 of xz, k2 of z, y, dz. So it's a product of two kernels. The operator is a product of two operators. And assume that they are both Hilbert-Schmidt, which could be our situation. It could be the sum of such objects. Now, what is the trace? Now, in all cases, the trace of k, that the integral over x of k of xx dx, this makes sense. It's just the double integral of k1 of xy, k2 of, k2 of z x dz dx. And now this is up to a bar. This is a scalar product of the Hilbert-Schmidt operator. So this is well defined. This is independent of the choice of k1 and k2. K2 such that this product holds. So if you represent the kernel as a product of two kernels, two Hilbert-Schmidt kernels, then the trace is well defined and it's just a scalar product up to a bar. So if you prefer, you put a bar here, and now it's really just a scalar product of k1 and k2. In the L2 of S cross X. So, and this is called the trace of k2. This is a way to avoid this theorem. It's as you like.
But Weimar, did you use that k is continuous here?
No, you don't use it. But you use that the k is given as a product. This is an equality for all x and y.
So this is an alternative to.
This is an alternative. Yeah, I said it's a variant. It's an alternative. But you insist that as a function is. It is equal to that. So there is a kind of continuity which is implicit. Because you take the product of two, it's a kind of like when you take a convolution product, generally it's more regular than the individual object. So you add some regularity by insisting that x and y are really defined by this formula, whatever it is. So now you're free to change the k1 and the k2. Up to measure zero set, but this will not modify the k because simply it's just well defined. It's a scalar product, so it's certainly well defined. so you see, but you have to insist that this is given by this formula. So it's up to you. In our case, the both work. So. Any way to look at is equivalent. Okay, so now you allow me to analyze this. I expect
Now you know that you have an expression for the trace by integrating the kernel over the diagonal. And this will give you the the geometric size of the trace formula. If you know the index theorem, this is we will get some kind of integral of some form and so on. So spectral size, geometric size. So again, I said that trace of R of F is the integral of the kernel G over gamma of k of xx dx, so kf of xx dx. So I write it in detail, G over gamma, the sum for gamma and gamma of f of x minus 1 gamma x dx. So that's the start. Now, what you will do, you just write gamma as the union of conjugacy classes. So, of say gamma, C gamma C minus 1. The set of this, with C in gamma, so I should write, C minus 1 gamma. Gamma modulo, the centralizer of small gamma in gamma. And so I write gamma as a union of conjugacy classes. And gamma belongs to what is usually denoted by this trace notation, which means a set of representative of conjugacy classes, of gamma conjugacy classes.
This razor.
Yeah. Choose a set of representative of conjugacy classes and you write the group as a union of conjugacy classes. That's as stupid as that. Now, your integral can be written, again, the trace of R F can be written as a sum. Now you can put the summation on the set of representative outside.
K gamma is elements of which compute bits come, yeah?
I forgot to say. I said it, but I didn't write it. Gamma is the transparizer. Oh, small gamma in gamma. Okay, thank you. So now you can put the sum of the set of representative outside, and you get the integral of G over gamma, sum for psi in gamma mod gamma index gamma of f of x minus 1 psi minus 1 gamma psi x dx. So, again, you can put together these two things, and so it's the sum of the gamma in the set of representative of the integral of the G over gamma index gamma, small gamma, of f of x minus 1 gamma x dx. And now this can again be rewritten. Series of small transformations, sometimes called the Selberg transformation, but it's very elementary. It's not nice to Selberg to to give this name. It's the same as the so-called Breuer decomposition. It's not so nice to call that after Breuer because it's somehow not so difficult. So it's written as the sum for gamma in the set of representative of the volume of now the centralizer of gamma in G, modulo the centralizer of gamma in gamma, times what is called an orbital integral, G over G gamma, of f of x minus 1 gamma x dx. Where G gamma, again, the centralizer of gamma in G. Since you can assume that f is positive, you see that all this manipulation makes sense. You know a priori that the integral is convergent. So after that, everything works, the G over gamma being compact. This implies in particular, that's also an exercise, this implies that these quotients are also, at least the volume is finite. That's clear from the manipulation in integration. So that's already clear. But moreover, in fact, it's true that these objects are compact. Okay, I let you do this exercise in topology. So now we can write completely the trace formula, Selberg trace formula for the compact case, where we obtain the so-called geometric expansion, and we already have the spectral expansion, and we can put everything together. So the trace formula is simply the equality. So the spectral size is the sum of n. I prefer m gamma of pi. That tells you everything. No, really, the multiplicity of pi in L2 of G of gamma. Trace of pi of f. So f is again a smooth compactly supported on G. This is equal to the sum over the set of representatives of conjugacy classes of volume of gamma gamma divided by G gamma times what is denoted often by O gamma of F, which is the orbital integral. Which means that this is the integral. This is O gamma of F. This is integral of F on the conjugacy class of gamma in G. That's what it is called, an orbital integral. So this is integral on the orbit under conjugation of small gamma in G. There is implicitly a choice of a hard measure on G gamma, but this is repeated twice, so whichever choice you make, the formula are the same. But of course, the individual expression depends on the choice of hard measure.
But left-hand side, it also depends on the choice of hard measure, yes?
So this depends on the choice of dx of a measure on G. Okay, this term, this is independent, and here